is Digital Voices with Bo Tiffany, inspiring and providing real insight to our listeners with every story, exploring deep stories behind every guest. Please welcome your host, Bo Tiffany.
Welcome, listeners, to Wanderlust with Karen Gershowitz. Karen's a travel addict, writer, photographer, and spent her life exploring the globe and capturing its beauty through her lenses. Karen's the author of the upcoming travel memoir, Wanderlust, Extraordinary People, Quirky Places, and Curious Cuisines, which is set to be published on October 3rd of this year, 2023, and can be pre-ordered now with the link that's in the description. So Karen, thank you for coming back. I talked to you a little bit when we first connected on this pre-podcast about how I've been following you on LinkedIn. So you've done a lot of traveling recently. Why don't you start out and give us a little bit of an update? What have you been up to lately?
Well, I'm making up for lost time because I was not doing a whole lot of traveling during COVID as we all were stuck at home. So I've gone to some extraordinary places. I finally got to Antarctica, which was the seventh continent. So that was very exciting. And I got to spend time in one of my favorite cities, Buenos Aires, which I love. So that was a fabulous trip. And then I went up to Vancouver and Vancouver Island and spent some time up there. Again, a place I've been to before, but went to places I hadn't been to up in that area. And I found out about somewhere that now I must go back for a third time. Maybe it's a fourth time. I take that back. Fourth time. Because apparently there's a ferry that goes up between between Vancouver Island and Vancouver. And there's a slew of islands up there. And the ferry just takes you around from all of the islands. Sounds absolutely gorgeous.
That does sound
beautiful. Yeah. I was down in Arkansas to go see the Crystal Bridges Art Museum, which I was very interested in going to for a long time. So that was on my list. You probably remember more than I do of where I've been.
You were just in Minnesota, weren't you?
Oh yeah, Wisconsin mostly. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was up in Wisconsin.
Close to me. I'm in Sheboygan. So yeah, I was pleasantly surprised.
Yeah, other end of the state.
What were you doing in Wisconsin?
Well, I actually went to a conference out there, and then I have very, very close friends, friend from college, who live in Minneapolis, but they have a cabin up near Spooner. Mm. And so I went and spent some time up there, which is just so beautiful. And they have a lovely cabin right on the lake, as I think everybody who lives up in northern Wisconsin does. But it's a lovely, lovely area. So that was great fun.
Yeah, we definitely live in the land of lakes in Wisconsin and Minnesota. So,
oh yeah, yeah,
a lot of beautiful places.
Well, I hear tell, in fact, that Wisconsin has more than Minnesota. They have 10,000 on their license plates, but you guys have more than that. So
yeah, it's a secret, but yeah, we like to boast about our cheese, but yeah, we have beautiful, beautiful places in Wisconsin. So. Any listeners traveled this way?
My dog is up here and wants to say hello, so I apologize, but he will not be denied. So,
yeah, pooch. So, yeah. Do you get to take your dog then with you on your travels?
He's a homebody. He does not like leaving. He barely likes going outside, so he doesn't. But I have a dog sitter who he loves, and it all works out really well.
Nice.
Yeah, well, that's exciting. I think I have my next 8 or 10 trips planned. So, literally,
that's amazing. You definitely keep busy. You know, let's talk about your new book. So, what inspired you to write it? I think the title gives it away, but could you give us a little bit more in depth?
Well, when the first book came out, I was doing a lot of PR for it and talking with lots of groups of people, and people kept saying, you have such great stories from your travels. Want to hear more about food, for sure. That was the first thing everybody said. And I thought, yeah, I probably have enough stories and I'll think about that one. And then Where's the most exotic place you've ever been to? And I started mentioning a few places that were not in the first book. And I said, oh, you got to write about that. One of them being Andamooka in Australia, which is possibly the most remote, not possibly, it is the most remote place I've ever been to. It is in the outback. It has a population of 30. And I was with my boyfriend and we flew in there in a four-seater plane, which we didn't think was going to happen, but that is what happened. And into this place that, you know, I'm looking at it going, where are we and how do you know where we are to the pilot? He pulls out a road map, points to it, and said, see that road? That's what we're following. And I'm looking down going, what road? In any event, it was an extraordinary experience. So that was the second thing. And then I wanted to write about people, which I had done it with, you know, travel companions, but not about people I met along the way who were really extraordinary for one reason or another. And so I picked a few of them. I had plenty more I could write about. And that's what the book became was people, places, and food. So that became the book. And what was interesting is people kept saying, you have all of these stories in the first book. Do you really have enough to write about? And I made a list. I have enough for about three or four more books. I'm not even close. I mean, I've been traveling since I'm 17, and a lot. And so, it's hard not to have lots of stories when you travel. In fact, I discovered the quote a long time ago and used it in the front page of the book because I thought it is the perfect quote for this book, which is traveling, it leaves you speechless, then turns you into a storyteller. And it's Ibn Battuta. And it's perfect. I mean, it fits it exactly. It's if you travel and you don't have stories, you've been doing something really wrong.
Ain't that the truth? So you have Wanderlust, which was your first book. How does this one
No,
differ?
first
I'm
book was
sorry.
Travel Mania.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I forgot. Travelmania and then Wanderlust, and now Wanderlust kind of part two, if you will. So how does this one differ from the first Wanderlust?
Well, Travel Mania, we're going to get this straight. Travel Mania was the first one. And that one is partially
Travelmania
memoir.
Stories of Wanderlust. Is that the full?
Wanderlust.
Okay,
Yeah,
that's
that's
where
the
I'm
full
getting it
title.
confused. Okay.
I know. I wanted to call this one Travel Mania 2, but my publisher said, no, you can't do that. But the first one was more memoir. It really was sort of the story of my life told through travel stories, and that was how I thought of the book. This one is just travel stories that are fun. Less to do with my life and more to do with what happens when you put yourself out there in the world. And and extraordinary things do happen. So it's not it's because it's my travels, I guess it's memoirish, but it really is more of just straight travel stories,
And we're
if that makes
focusing
sense.
more kind of a little bit on other people's stories too, right? And then quirky places and curious cuisines. So let me start with the food because, as you can tell, I have a little bit of love for food.
Everybody loves food stories. That's the first thing anybody wants to know about. So I'm not so I could write a whole book about food stories. I might do that at some
What are some of your food? Give me a couple samples, maybe
point.
ones
Okay,
that
well, I'll
aren't
give
in
you
the book.
that are not in the book. Well, I'll give you one that is in the book just because it's such a good story. It's the worst meal I've ever eaten, bar none, anywhere on the globe at any point in my life. I was traveling in Tanzania and I was doing the Cheap Charlie version because I had no money at the time. And we got out to a very, very remote area. We were in the Ngorongoro crater camping there. And we go out on a drive, as it's turning into evening because that's when the animals are all out. And we come back and we're scurrying around before the light disappears completely to get whatever we needed. And we hear a shriek. I mean, literally a shriek. And we all go running out. We're thinking an animal has killed someone. You know, who knows what's gone on? And there's the tour guide. And he's going, "It's all okay. It's all okay. I'll let you know. I'll show you what happened when we have dinner." Okay. So we come back out, and now you have to understand that Tanzanians and Westerners do not eat the same things at all. They eat, God, I can't remember the name of it, but it's a kind of a paste that they make into different forms, and they eat with things. Anyhow, they do not understand Western food in the slightest. And they were being taught by someone who's British. So we'll start off with that. Not a good combination. And the food, anyhow, what the cook had done was take what was supposed to be three separate courses and combine them all into one huge bowl. So we had pasta, we had tinned vegetables, we had sardines, topped by canned fruit. With the sardines decorating it and condensed sweetened milk poured over the whole thing. And there was nothing else to eat.
Wow. Now, is this
Yeah.
what they eat normally, or was this special for
No,
tourists? Still for tourists.
was neither. It's nothing that they would eat at all, but they didn't understand that it was supposed to be one dish of pasta with sauce on it,
Sure. So
one
they
dish
just kind
with. Right. And it all just got combined. And let me tell you know, we all looked at it and groaned and then started picking up things and wiping it off because it had the sardine oil and it also had the cream and God, it was ugh. So that was the possibly the worst meal I've ever
I was
had.
not
At the
expecting that, just to say. In
other
your other,
what were you expecting?
well, we're looking at, Africa, Tanzania. I'm thinking, maybe wild game or, something exotic. But instead you're eating canned, fruits and vegetables with pasta kind of shoved in there for a little extra texture or something.
And sardines,
I don't
and
know. Oh,
sardines.
yes. Can't forget
We
those.
can't forget the sardines. Yeah, sardines and fruit salad are not a good combination.
So that's like
But in
a
any event,
weight loss excursion waiting to happen.
we all lost weight on that. Everybody, whether we wanted to or not, because when you're out in the bush, I mean, there's nowhere you can get additional food. They had enough food for when we were traveling, and that was it. And so you didn't eat it, too bad. Yeah, I would not recommend it. I don't think anybody would even go on that kind of trip anymore. It was a long time ago, but a memorable meal to say the very least. At the other end of the spectrum, one of the best meals I ever had, and this one is not in the book, is I have friends who live in Torino or Turin, Italy. And they decided that they were going to take me out for a very, very fancy dinner. They had friends who owned I don't know, Michelin starred restaurant, I think, and a very close friend of theirs. So we go in and we sit down, and the first we get a course of, I don't even remember what the appetizer was, and it's fabulous. And I eat the whole thing, and then we get some ice. Gelato kind of thing as a palate cleanser. And of course, we're having wine, different wine with every course. And then comes out soup. And then comes out the next course. The problem was they hadn't told me that this was going to be a nine-course meal. And had I known that, I would have taken two bites and stopped. But of course, the food was phenomenal. It was truly some of the best food I've ever eaten in my life. But by the end of it was, oh my God, I can't eat another bite. But then I didn't want to be rude. Plus, I was a little drunk by that point because I was drinking wine the whole time. But it was an astounding meal. And you were asking about where I've been this year. The other thing that I didn't mention is I went to Italy for a cooking class. I was in Lucca, which is in Tuscany, and I was there for 10 days learning how to cook authentic Tuscan food, which was phenomenal. And I have to say, the meals there were amazing. You know, it's like it's hard to have a bad meal in Italy.
Yeah.
It's really hard to have a bad.
I think I talked to you before you left and I said, bring me back the secret to the croissants because their croissants are unlike anything we get here in the States. And I don't know what makes them so special. It's they're light and fluffy and just so delicious. It's almost like their own food group. So it
Yeah.
was, yeah, their breads over there are just amazing. I don't know what makes it
Oh, yeah.
special. Do you?
The flour they use for one thing. I was amazed because one of the things that he was teaching us, I mean, we had this master chef who was teaching the class. It was a professional cooking school, and they were teaching us. And so it was really high-end stuff. They have, I think, six or seven different qualities of flour. And depending upon what you're doing and what you're baking or cooking with the flour, you use a different grade of flour. And we don't have, we have, all-purpose flour. That's what we use,
Right,
you
yeah.
know, if you're using wheat. I mean, and then there's semolinas, and they have, three different grades of semolina flour. And all of these things that we can't even get, even if we wanted to. And I think that's part of it. But part of it's also that, it's local to the area. They know what they're doing. It's like, I'm a native New Yorker, and there is no bagel in the world like a New York bagel. There just
Right.
isn't. What makes it a New York bagel? People will say it's the water. People will say, it's all kinds of things. It's New Yorkers know how to make bagels, and French know how to make croissants, and the Italians know how to make, what they make. And it's very different, because it's kind of a tradition, I think.
So what makes
And yes.
flour different grades? Is it the way they grind it? Is it the grain
Yeah.
that they're using? Or I guess I never heard
Part,
that.
I think it's all wheat, so I can't imagine, maybe, like spring wheat or winter wheat. And it's also how fine it is. And I'm not even sure, but he would say, no, you have to use number five for this. You can't use number two. Okay. What, and we were asking him, and he was, he did explain some of it, some of which I'd forgotten, but I know it has to do with the fineness of it. And I think it does have to do whether it's spring wheat or winter wheat or
Interesting.
fall wheat. Yeah.
Well,
And maybe
and
some.
those are all just amazing stories and the experiences that go along with them. I mean, it's a fulfilling life that you lead.
Well, I think I have the best life ever. I mean, and especially now that I'm retired and I can really travel the way I've always wanted to, but for obvious reasons, when you're earning a living, it's not a little, it's a lot more difficult. But
Yeah.
it's great fun, and I intend to keep doing it as long as I possibly can.
And that brings us to a point. Last time we talked, we were talking about what it's like to travel in the golden years, and how long can you keep traveling? So can you talk a little bit, how has travel changed for you over the years?
Well, I can't, certainly can't do the things. There's no way I could go on a trip like I went to in Tanzania, which I did when I was in my 30s. And I climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. Not even a possibility at this point. But there are many things I can still do. And I've learned to pace myself. I don't go at a frantic pace. I tend to go to one place and stay there for a while and really get to know it. I was recently down in Mexico, and I was staying in the town of Ixtapa, and I'd never even heard of it before. And it turned out to be this gorgeous place, had a great time, took a couple of day trips, but mostly I was just in the town. And I'm more inclined to do that now than to try and go to a, move around very much.
Sure.
And I'm finding that just slowing down makes it a different experience, and I get to know a place better, and I get to meet people, and I really, really enjoy it. But it's different. It's a
Yeah.
very different kind of travel. I can't walk as much as I used to. It's just not even a possibility. I've got some health issues. But again, it doesn't mean that you can't do it. You just do it a little bit differently. And in
And
fact,
it, you
that's
know,
what
it,
my next book is going to be about. I've already
yeah.
started writing the next book, and that's exactly what it's about.
And I think it's an important topic. You know, I'm nearly 50. I'll be 50 next year. And so for me, you know, I'm getting the aches and pains, and you know, I have things that have gone wrong that have caused, you know, injuries to the spine. So I can't do quite what I used to do, you know, and knowing that there's still options is really important for people because a lot of times they just don't know. And especially for me, I've traveled, I think I shared with you last time, like 12 different countries. And, you know, for me, I love those experiences. I'm very much a Wanderlust traveler. You know, I love taking in the best elements that I can from the different cultures because the world is such a beautiful, big, amazing place. And there's so many different types of people and the cultures that go along with it. It's just a such a beautiful tapestry that the world has to offer. So, you know, I think knowing, you know, what we can do, you know, as we get older, and that traveling's not something to rule out, and that, you know, there's things that, you know, we might look at and be in touch with a little bit more, I think is important to share because a lot of people have that opinion, you know, well, I'm too old to do that. You know, I don't want to, you know. And I think that there's a lot, not everywhere, but it's getting there, a lot more accessibility for
Absolutely.
people, especially help, you know, couriers and all sorts of things, for when you're traveling, especially depending on where you go, that could be very helpful for somebody that's older.
Yeah, and the other thing is there are loads of groups that are specifically designed for people who are older. And you know, not that you need to travel with older people, but they'll give you services or they'll tell you, you know, how do you find transportation in a city that's accessible to you. You know, all kinds of things like that. And in truth, I've become a staff writer and I'm on the editorial board of a group called Journey Woman, which is for solo female travelers 50 and over. And we've got people who are still traveling, still writing, who are well into their 80s, and I do mean well into their 80s, who are doing amazing things. And they've figured out how to do it. And they're sharing that with everybody who belongs to Journey Woman, which is turning out to, it's growing very quickly. And if anybody out there is older and wants information, it's free. You know, I'll give them a little pitch because it's a great group. But it's invaluable because people share their experiences and their knowledge. And how do you do it? There's one woman who is a bit younger, but she's in a wheelchair and she's traveled over the entire globe and she gives all this advice on how do you do it if you're in a wheelchair. And she said, I'm not going to allow it to stop me. And, you know, and I give her kudos for doing that because it shouldn't stop her. It really shouldn't.
So I'll share a secret. So I'm disabled and I don't share that much from an accident that I had on one of my travels. And so I need to get help through the airport and such. And I almost wish it was like it's so easy for me to travel now because I can get a shuttle from point A to point B. And if it's especially a large airport, that's extremely helpful. But then there's also they kind of just cut you through lines and so they make it very convenient, I think, to travel in a way that I never expected. And so that was one thing
Yeah.
that I wanted to mention because especially mentioning the friend that you have that's in the wheelchair, you know, that's how I was getting carted through the airports. And you know, it's amazing how well they have that set up. You know, it's so efficient and seamless for the most part that I was very impressed. And our
Yeah.
FAA really has their stuff together when it comes to that too.
Well, and they have it overseas as well. I mean, I recently had surgery and I've, you know, I've been in Mexico since then and I've been in Italy since then. I was up in Canada and they were fabulous. They were absolutely fabulous and people are very friendly and lovely and help you and you know, and first I thought, "Oh, and then why am I doing this? You know, I could do it on my own." But the truth is, it's very long distances and I probably couldn't have. And once I realized, you know, there's no shame in taking a wheelchair if you need one, it was like, oh yeah, this is a whole lot easier. And it means I can conserve my energy for the things that I want to use my energy on, as opposed to trudging through an airport.
Yeah, I agree.
So.
I just think that people have the opinion that they can't, and I want that roadblock, that mental roadblock, to at least come down a little bit to realize that they really can, and things are set up to be able to, especially the most of the places that you want to travel to these days. Like you said, the infrastructure is worldwide, it's global. So,
Absolutely. Absolutely.
let's talk a little bit about specific places or cultures that have significantly influenced your writing.
My writing. I don't know that places and cultures have influenced what I write about, yes, but the actual writing, not so much. I mean, the writing comes from years of journal. And I think I mentioned that last time, that my mother got me into it when I was 8 years old. And we went down to Florida, I think, to visit my grandmother. And she said, you have to keep a journal, because if you don't keep a journal, you're never going to remember what we did. I still have the journal from when I was 8 years old, with little drawings. And she got me into that habit. Every time we went anywhere, keep a journal. And so I've been keeping a travel journal since I am 8 years old.
Wow,
Now,
how
when I
many
was
books?
traveling for business, well, it's all mostly on my computer. In fact, I think at this point I have everything, including when I was 8 years old, that one, you know, which I did, you know, I took images of so I could have the drawings. But yeah, I've got all of them. In fact, people will say to me often when I'm writing, or when they read the book, how do you remember all these details? I mean, it's incredible what you remember. And I said, you want to see my journals? That's how I have it. And of course, when I do that, plus I'm a really avid photographer, as you know, the combination of having written impressions and experiences and having the photographs that go with it, I can go immediately back to where it is. It's enough of a trigger to remind me of lots of things. So, you know, that's more influential than any specific places. But it's been a lifelong habit. And somebody said to me, I was actually teaching a class about travel yesterday, and somebody said to me, so what do you put in the journal? Because I know there are people who just write, well, we stayed at this hotel and ate at this restaurant, and here's what we ate. And I said, do you know, I don't know any of that. I couldn't tell you where I stayed most of the time, because I don't write that in the journal. What I write about are experiences. I met someone, and I'll spend, you know, a half a page writing about someone who I met and what my impressions were and what happened and how I met them. Or I'll write about something that just really sparked my interest. That's what those journals are about. They're not about, you know, I did this and then I did this and then I did this, because that's not all that interesting.
Right. Well, one thing I did find interesting that you shared about your first book was you shared the relationships and the loves that you've made along the way and through your travels. And so I found that to be very interesting, because I think all of us are voyeuristic in a certain small way, and so hearing about somebody else's famous adventures, abroad, especially somewhere where we can only imagine what it might be if we've never traveled there, especially, then turns into be kind of fantasical in a way to the listener. And I find that enjoyable. So
Yeah, well, you know, you do have those experiences for sure.
but I also wanted to kind of tip that for our listeners for your first book. You mentioned that it was full of more of your memoirs, and those include, those loves and those stories. And I find that, again, those are some of the most interesting parts to me. Although I haven't read your new book yet, so that has yet to be seen. So your process, we talked about your photography. you have a process for capturing and selecting photos for your books?
Well, I can only put one photo at the start of each chapter that's published, because it starts to get very, very expensive. And I just pick one that's representative of what that experience was. But on my website, I have photographs for every chapter of the book. So that if you go onto it, it's KarenGershowitz.com, and you go to the book, you can go and you'll see we're putting Wanderlust up, the new book up, but for Travelmania, it's all up there, and you can see literally hundreds of pictures that go with each of the chapters in the book. So, and it's funny, you were mentioning, loves and it being very memoirish. One of the chapters that lots and lots of people have told me about in Travelmania that they really remember was my final trip with my mother to Puerto Rico. And it was a really heart-wrenching trip. And I wrote that chapter in one day, maybe. I took a few hours, because it was so, I remember every detail of that trip, every detail. And she died, I think it was 3 days after we got home. And I spent the entire trip going, please don't die while we're in Puerto Rico. Please don't die while down here. But it was, that one is, I cannot tell you how many people have said to me that that was like this heart-wrenching chapter, but that it's really impactful. Mm-hmm. So it's both the good stuff and the not so good stuff.
That connection for you as a traveler, it must have been powerful to have that. It's your last trip with your mom, and then shortly after, and even during, you were worried about her. So for you, for that to be your story, I think is powerful, and also says a lot about who you are as a person. That could only happen to Karen Gershowitz, probably not most other people. So, we talk about a lot of the stories. Let's pick out a piece of advice or two, or some wisdom for aspiring traveling writers. I think the journaling is really a good tip and tool. Yes. Anything else that you could add to that?
Yeah. What I have found invaluable, and it doesn't happen all at once, is all I can say, is the first book took me forever, partially because I was working full time, even more than full time. But I was taking writing workshops, and then I got together a group of writers, and I've been in a writing group for about 20 years now, and it's invaluable. First of all, it keeps me on track, because I have to keep submitting things. So I can't stop, because I can't, because they're all expecting me to write, and so I write. And they're also providing a huge amount of invaluable advice and encouragement. There are lots of ways to find writing groups. There's some online ones. My writing group, we started on Zoom, it started on Zoom during COVID, and we don't meet in person anymore. We used to. And so now we've got people from all over the country as part of my writing group. But I strongly advise that. I've said that to a number of people, people who've taken the advice also say that it becomes one of the most valuable things to keep you on track. And also because people give you great critique. As a writer, you can't necessarily see that there's a problem in something, because I know the story. What do you mean it doesn't make sense?
Right.
Well, there's a time gap here that I don't understand. Oh, okay. I have to fix the timeline. So, things like that are, if you can possibly join a writer's group, I would do that for sure. And read a lot of travel writing. That's the other thing, is just read a lot of travel writing. There's so many fabulous travel writers out there. I got inspired by Bill Bryson. I love his writing. It's
what was the name?
Enormously, Bill Bryson.
Okay.
Bryson. And he's written, 7 or 8, maybe more than that, travel books. And they are both very funny and very very much of a place and a time, and they're wonderful. And then there's an Irish writer, Dervla Murphy, who she travels in a way that I would never travel. Her first book, which was written quite a long time ago when she was, I think, 30, she lived in Ireland with a name like Dervla Murphy, one would think. And it's called Full Tilt. And she traveled by bicycle from Ireland up into the Himalayas and over the Himalayas.
Wow.
And it is a wild ride. Trust me, I would never even consider doing this. And then she does, she has one where she's with her daughter and a mule in Peru, and they're going over the Peruvian Andes. And it's called 8 feet in the Andes. And it's hers, her daughter's, and the mule. And she and her daughter, and her daughter's young. It's like, really? You took your young daughter on this insane trip? But she did. In any event, read a lot of travel writing, because what it'll do is it'll give you a sense of what travel writing can be. And it can be many, many different things. And you're going to find a style, or you're going to find a way of telling stories that you relate to. And that's what you end up using as kind of a model for yourself. So.
Do you get any inspiration from feedback from readers? Does that help shape in that writing process?
All the time, all the time. And also from editors. It's been interesting because, as I said, this book came out directly from people saying to me, tell us more about food. You have so many good stories. That's exactly how this book came about, because I was originally going to focus on something else. The next book came about because what my goal in all of this is not just to tell stories, but I really want to encourage people to travel. I think it's the best possible thing you could do. And I think it would be, incredible in terms of making the world a saner place if more people got out and really understood that there's not just one right way of doing things, that all people basically want the same things. They may come do them slightly differently, or sometimes even very differently, but they want their children to have an education. They want to live well. They want to have food. Not any different. It's the human condition. It just plays out a little bit differently. In any event, so my goal is to get people to travel. And I was doing a lot of classes and live broadcasts with audiences, promoting the first book. And since then, to this day, people ask me to teach classes about travel. And the feedback that I get often is, I don't know how to begin. Or, as we were talking about before, well, I'm kind of older. I don't know if I really want to keep doing this. It's a little scary for me. I'm worried about this. I'm worried about that. And then I would talk to them, and I would say, well, start off going somewhere local. Start off with a small group where they into a place that speaks English. Don't go to the most remote place on the earth. That's not how you start. And I would give all kinds of advice. Well, I've had two different people within, I don't know, a year maybe, get back to me afterwards and say, I can't thank you enough. I took your advice and I'm signed up for a trip to London, or I'm signed up for a trip to Quebec, whatever it is. And I was so excited by it. It was like, yes. And people have told me when they've met me, and on, I write on Facebook, I write on LinkedIn all the time. And people will tell me that I'm inspiring them to get out and go places. And for me, that's the reward in all this. It really is. It's just getting people to go and experience it for themselves.
Well, and it's good that you're getting that feedback, because there's nothing better for you. I think, you're putting your heart and your soul in your stories. The reward, like you said, is it's getting people addicted, getting that fire to spread, you know, that desire to travel, those adventures, and that global connectivity that results as a result of creating those connections and experiences. I think, like you said, it brings us together as a humanity. We see that we're not so different typically. Our foods might be different. You know, it might be a paste made into various things at one place. It might be some insects in another. It might be, you know, various wild game. But there's always something everywhere so far that I've found that I enjoyed, you know. So you might not like everything, but if you're willing to try, it opens up your palate, and then also the amazing variety of foods that you can come across, I think is what I love the most. One of my favorite stories is when I visited Cyprus and went to a Syrian restaurant, which very much like yours, everything came out in courses. And we sat on pillows, and then we had agilas, or hookahs is what they call them here in the States. You know, and so it was like a 3-hour meal. Didn't expect it to be that long. Ate more than I should myself. Thankfully, we had time to kind of digest and talk, and it was a social event. You know, it was very much a social, rather than just going somewhere, feeding, shoving your stomach full, and then you bounce to wherever you're going to go. This was the event, you know? So yeah, yes. I love that. You know, drawing closer to our hour, but we still have a little bit of time. I want to ask, because right in your title, we talk about the quirky or the extraordinary people in quirky places. We talked about some quirky places. We talked about the cuisine. We talked about a couple of people that you met along the way.
Well, one of them happened in the U.S. And it's in the book. I went out to go see the Devil's Tower. I love Close Encounters of the Third Kind. It's one of my absolute favorite movies, and I had to go see it in person. And you understand when you go there, and I was driving, why they pick that as the place, because it is, you drive forever, you could see it way in the distance, and there's nothing else, totally flat, except for the Devil's Tower. Mm-hmm. And I get out there, and I'm staying at the only place you can stay, which is the KOA campground. And I had a tent, and I would have put up a tent, except that they said to me, oh, we have cabins. Do you want to stay in a cabin? And I think it was, you know, not in season. So it was like $10 more. I was like, yes, cabin sounds great. I don't have to put up the tent. Perfect. And I go into the cabin. And as soon as I get in there, these two women, I hear a knock on the door, and there's two women standing there covered with sawdust and paint. Well, they call themselves the cabin doctors. And they are, it's two American women who make their living repairing cabins all over the country. Some in national parks, some in state parks, some in private campgrounds. They don't have a home. Their mother gets their mail for them. Most places up at the Devil's Tower, there is, at the time I was there, there was no radio reception at all. So they're totally cut off. I said, how do you even know where the next job is? Oh, our mother takes care of it for us. You don't have a home at all? No. They have a small trailer. They live in it. And they were sisters, and they were traveling, and they've been doing it for a couple of years. And it goes beyond that. The story goes beyond that. But they were two of the most interesting people I've met in a long time. And not the place I would ever have expected to, but we ended up having a couple of meals together, and they had a dog, and I'm a real dog lover. So it just got to be a really fun experience spending time with them. And they were extraordinary people. They lived a life unlike any that I ever imagined. And for me, that's, you know, makes me think a little bit differently. So
outside of the box. They definitely have.
Absolutely outside of the box. And what they said was, you know, when we want to take a vacation, we go back to one of the places that we really loved where we were working, and just go hang out there for a couple of weeks. And the owners know us, and we don't have to pay anything. And that's our vacation, is to be in a gorgeous place. And we never go back to the same place twice to repair cabins, because part of our goal is to really see the country. I was like, that's a pretty extraordinary life.
Absolutely.
I don't know if they're still
Yes.
doing it, but they did it for quite a while. So, and I wanted to stay in touch with them, but you couldn't, because there was no way to get in touch with them. So.
It's amazing the people that you meet along the way. And, I don't know if you're religious or not, but I find that sometimes I've had a very blessed life in some ways, and along with my fair share of struggles, like everyone. But the thing that I find is my experiences have been almost divine, like crazy, wonderful experiences, and then some scary ones too, but it didn't hurt me, and I didn't get hurt, but it was still an exhilarating story that I can share and look back on and say, wow, how is your life when you look at it? I can only imagine it must feel the same way for you.
Oh, absolutely. I have lived a very blessed life. I absolutely have thought that for a very long time. And did I make some bad decisions? Sure. Did I do some things? But boy, I look at it and go, I have had the most unbelievable either divine grace or luck or something. That I've been able to live the way I've been able to live. I also give a lot of credit, quite honestly, to my mother, who was an extraordinary, really extraordinary. She was very far ahead of her time, very far ahead of her time. This is a woman who got a degree in architecture at Cooper Union in New York in the early 1930s. So, and then, of course, she could never get hired because no one would hire a female architect, despite the fact that she was at the top of her class. That was irrelevant. It's kind of the story of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who, had was at the top of her class and couldn't get a job in a law firm. Well, my mother couldn't get one in an architecture firm, but she lived her life, and she had a lot of physical issues, but she was, she lived life every single day. And I give her a lot of credit for kind of shaping me that way. And in fact, the first chapter of the new book is about learning about the world while I was living in New York. As a child, my mother was very, when I was a child, my mother was very, very adventurous. And we went to every cuisine she could find to try it. We went to every museum and looked at it. We went to every performance that came in from anywhere on the globe so that I could experience, a dance company or a music or whatever it was. And it really inspired me because I wanted to go see these things in person for myself. And
There's a tangible connection that you get too. So it's one thing to read about it. What inspired me to travel was, we had a collection of National Geographics going back to the late 1800s before there was even black and white. So it was all descriptive text and Machu Picchu discovery. And then, I read about King Tut's tomb, which is the first color photo, and just having the entire collection and reading all of them inspired me to travel. And being able to tangibly put my hands or my feet where these people stepped and where this history occurred, it gave me a sense of a being that I don't think I would have ever developed had I not traveled and had those experiences. But I think it's so part of the human condition, knowing our roots and connecting with our roots. And we're not from America, our history is European. And so, when we travel in America, we see things that are, at earliest from the 1700s. when we travel over to Europe, we're seeing things potentially that are much, much older. Rome's a great example with, is it the Pantheon?
Colosseum.
Yeah,
I mean,
many buildings still standing from that, you know, a couple thousand years ago. It's amazing. It really, truly is. And so for me, that connection, that tangible connection, both to our history as humans, as well as to what I read and was really interested in as a kid, was something that really helped me blossom as a person. And for yourself, I can only imagine, you know, all the places you've been and all the experiences and people and sharing the culture and experiences from all those different places has made you just a wonderfully terrific, well-rounded, interesting person that I'm privileged to call a friend. So
thank you. And it's interesting that you're talking about history in a building. The friends who I mentioned who live in Turin in Italy, that their home has been in the family for, I think they told me, 15 generations.
Oh, wow.
Imagine that one, 15 generations, and it's the same family. And, you know, doesn't get more, I can't even fathom that.
And that's, you know, another thing, the connection to the land and the buildings and the history, you know, imagine having 15 generations. You can't have that in the States. And so we don't have that deep, deep connection that comes with some of the places that you can visit. And there's something to be said about that. You know, we take pride in being Americans and with our own history. But imagine if that history stretched back, you know, hundreds and hundreds, you know, of years, or 1,000 years, or a couple thousand years. That's why people in Egypt, you know, or a lot of these other places have such a deep passion for their land, because their culture, their family, their history is tied to it. And that's something that I didn't realize the depth of until I experienced it firsthand, you know.
Yeah, it is a very, we have such a young history. Mm-hmm. You know, we're such a new country, that it really makes a difference going somewhere that's got, you know, thousands of years of history, and you can go see it, and experience, feel it. It's a very different experience than anywhere you can go in North America. Well, not Mexico. Anywhere in the US or Canada.
But we're living in a time that we're really privileged, because for the first time ever, you know, we're able to visit these places. Borders are pretty easy to cross with a visa or a passport for the most part. There's not a lot of travel restrictions for the most part. And the world is such a big place. It's your oyster, you know. So if you love the tropics, or if you love the mountains, or if you love old buildings and architecture, whatever your fancy is, you can find it. And talking to Americans that are listening to this podcast, you know, get outside of our borders and experience that history. It will change your life. And so with that, any closing words or anything I can bring up? I know you said you're going to be starting even another book, focusing on some of the other topics that we discussed.
Right.
This one's coming out October 3rd, they're going to be able to get it right off your website?
If you go onto the website, it'll direct you onto Amazon or Barnes & Noble or Indie Books, but you can get it pretty much anywhere.
Excellent.
It's, you know, it's widely distributed. So.
I remember last time we talked to you, you were having a tough time remembering the title. And I'm glad I had written it down, because it's a mouthful, but I love it. And it envelops really what the book's about. So
Well, I originally wanted to just call it Wanderlust, People, Places, and Food. And my publisher said no. So I said, all right, well, I'll come up with something that conveys that, because that's what the book is about. So it is a mouthful, but I like it. And I sometimes forget it, so don't feel bad.
I like it, though. I do. It's catchy, and I look forward to the next one. You know, I appreciate you, and I appreciate your stories, and the inspiration that you're spreading. You know, it's right up my alley. It's the things that made me who I am. You know, the person that I am today would not be who I am if I hadn't had those experiences. And like I said, I kind of feel like, you know, the river of life, if you immerse yourself and you allow yourself to just get out there and do things, the world opens up before you in a way that, like I said earlier, almost seems divine. You know, it, at least in my experiences and yours too, it sounds like, you know, it's putting yourself in these situations allows life to happen. And, but if you stay at home and you're just doing the in and out, life can go by real quick and you miss out on so much. So, you know, I'm very much into inspiring that spirit of travel and inspiring that spirit of adventure, because like you said, it connects us all, and I love what you're doing.
Well, thanks. Yeah, I'm quite passionate about it, as you have obviously picked up on. And yeah. Just get out there and go do it. There's something out there for everyone. There's no one right way of traveling. Do what feels right, but go out and experience it.
I will send you a link to this when I get it done. I'm going to share it. And I'd also like to touch base again once you get that third one knocked out.
Oh, absolutely.
And, yeah, I love it. And I appreciate you. So thank you for coming on.
Likewise. And by all means, do send me your address and I will send you a signed copy tomorrow if you get it to me tonight, because I'm going to the post office anyhow.
All right.
I will absolutely get that to you. It was great talking with you.
Likewise. You have yourself a great day and keep traveling.
And if I get up to Sheboygan, which I am going to do because I want to go see the, I'm also a big collector of outsider art. And that's where the, what's the name of the group? It's the they make toilets and sinks. And why am
Kohler.
I losing?
Kohler Company.
The Kohler Foundation is up there.
Yeah.
I really want to go see their collection. So I will be in Sheboygan.
You will love it. It's a great experience. And just to expound on that, Kohler actually built the town of Kohler. And so the plant's almost like the entire town, and it's very unique. And like you said, they have a museum that has all of the stuff they've ever produced, but it also houses the only 5-star restaurant in our area. And so it's an amazing place. They have an amazing spa to go with it. It's called the American Club. So I highly recommend taking a look at that, because that would be a really great experience for you while you're there.
Yeah, well, I am definitely going to do it, because I absolutely want to go see that museum. I've been told, you know, I've taken a tour of Wisconsin to go see all of the environments that artists, self-taught artists, have created. And they spent all of this money preserving them. And it was fabulous. And then, but they didn't have a museum at that point that they exhibited this apparently extensive collection of outsider art. And so it is on my list, and probably in 2024 I will get into Sheboygan. So I will keep you in mind.
Do that. I will be your chauffeur or your tour guide, either way. There's a lot in this
sounds
area.
Like a plan.
There's a lot in this area that's quite extraordinary. And you know, while we were talking about America has a young history, this area has a fishing industry history going back, you know, to our early roots. And we have a town close by that used to have plank roads to get to it. So we still have a plank road as one of the roads that we have following the old trail. And there's some inns in places that you can still visit that have been turned into museums that are really amazing.
Cool.
Just with that history and that connection. So I look forward to it. Until then.
This has been Digital Voices with Bo Tiffany, exploring deep stories from real life guests with real life experiences, providing insight to our listeners with every story. Stay up to date on future podcasts by bookmarking Digital Voices with Bo Tiffany.podbean.com and follow Bo on social media by searching Digital Voices with Bo Tiffany. Have an idea for a future story? Send your idea to acrmadison@gmail.com. Until next time, grab life by the horns and keep inspiring others.